What's up, everybody? It's Cosmo the Goaty here, and welcome to my playthrough of Full Throttle Remastered. Now, I have already played Full Throttle on my YouTube channel, as you may be able to find out if you go look. I'm a big fan of the original game, and I can't believe it was released 22 years ago. Jeez, that makes me feel really damn old. As you may know, I'm a big fan of adventure games and a big fan of LucasArts adventure games. I played Day of the Tentacle Remastered last year. Had a blast remembering all the fun stuff and just seeing the game sort of improved greatly. I've heard really good things about this remastering, how they've taken the original audio and remastered it, the music, and placed into stereo because it was really compressed. Just to give you an idea, basically, the download of this game is 5 gigabytes. The original game fitted on one CD-ROM, so you can hopefully understand the amount of audio and the improvements they want to have made to the game to actually do this. So without further ado, I'm going to hit play and see what they have done to an extreme classic of the game. Ooh. You can't see this yet. It's not. Okay. Nice. Ooh, all right. Now, as always, since I've played this game originally, I'm going to put audio commentary on. Ooh, jukebox. Oh, they're all locked. I'll just double check everything here. Switch render mode. Yep, okay. All right. Let's do this.
Hello, everybody. I am Tim Schaefer. I was the project leader on Full Throttle.
Hi, Tim.
And welcome to this exciting commentary.
I'm Larry Ahern, and I was lead animator. Whenever I
smell I'm Casey Ackley. I was production manager.
I'm Stephen Shaw, and I was the lead programmer.
I'm Peter McConnell, and I was the composer.
And I'm Clint Bajikian, and lead sound designer.
I'll tell you what I'll do. Hang on. I put the subtitles on. That's what I was going to do. So you can actually tell what's being.
The reason you're not doing it like drunk history.
Would you like a drink?
Wouldn't that be funny? No, not right now. I think we come up with a lot more stories.
Yeah, we'll do that for our YouTube channel.
Okay.
Drunk game commentary. All right, you guys.
Asphalt. And trouble.
Rip Burger, you're dumber than dirt.
Mr. Corley, if you'd...
So this is our dramatic intro to the game. We want to be super cinematic. And it has the fabulous voice of Roy Conrad, the late, great Roy Conrad. And now we're getting into our celebrity voiceover. Anyone know who the celebrity is?
Yes. Mark Hamill.
Mark Hamill as Ripburger, super evil.
He does a great job.
He's amazing.
He sure does.
We knew a little bit that he would do a great job, not just from the Star Wars stuff, but he was already the Joker at this time. He's already the Joker.
Yeah.
One of the animated TV series.
So who was Corley?
Malcolm Corley was Hamilton Camp. Hamilton Camp, who was also passed away, unfortunately. There's my wife.
Oh, yeah, you gotta go back to that. It's Little Gold Tim.
Little Gold Tim Butt.
Oh, there'll be a glory shot of that later.
That was a Charlie Ramos.
I remember Peter McConnell making fun of me for the destabilizing inner air condition line. Here goes Ben Throttle. Now, this is... are we using the Rebel Assault engine yet? Oh, wait. My nude scene's coming up. Everybody cover your eyes. Nobody look.
There it is. All right.
The only difference...
exposure.
Yeah, you're welcome, everybody, for that. And some great Gone Jackals music comes in here. This is still an introduction that I loved to watch because it was so... It was really different than Day of the Tentacle, which was our last game, where we had a lot of trouble just getting the Founding Fathers to animate as they jumped out the window when you chopped down when you scared them out of the Constitutional Congress. Moving that many pixels on the screen was impossible, but this time we were using the Rebel Assault Engine, which was called...
Smush.
Yeah. And Steve,
well, how did... It's the insane engine.
Wait, now what... Okay, right, you tell us what's going on here.
The insane engine. It was the insane engine. Smush was the tool that you created the insane streams with.
Right. So this came about because of the advent of CD-ROMs, which had basically infinite storage. right. compared to what we're used to on the 3.5 inch. Oh, look at these amazing credits. There comes Steve's.
Glory shot.
Yeah, nice. Of course.
Try getting these today in Call of Duty or what have you.
What, opening right. credits? Yeah. I love opening credits. Yeah. I guess I feel like they just set the mood.
Yeah.
And they, Brian Rich. They set the mood and they make you feel like you're going to see something awesome and epic.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So you get to hear all this awesome music.
Live band?
So CD-ROMs came out and Myst was a big hit, and then Lucas made Rebel Assault, which was like took 3D rendered trenches and you could fight TIE fighters in these trenches, right?
Right.
And then we're like, we'll take that.
Yeah, Vince came up with the streaming engine and it did really well, and he kept doing improvements on it for Rebel Assault 1, Rebel Assault 2, etc., etc. And this got put into here, and
it was mind-boggling at the time because he's like, look, I'm gonna do this thing. It's gonna store the data for one frame, and then the next frame, it's not gonna have the whole frame. It's only gonna have the data that changed. And we're like, what? That's a compression idea that has never been. That's crazy. So it allowed us to like do full screen animation.
Okay, so we missed pretty much the whole song, but that's kind of cool actually.
Hey, Ben. You know, Ben, we're broke.
Yeah.
And if some cash doesn't come our way soon, we're in
damn
trouble.
Look at it. Relax. Old?
I have a feeling something's coming our
that
way.
That is cool.
Something big.
You better stay out here, Rip. This place is bikers only.
I love that old guy.
Who's the guy that drove over my car?
What could possibly be taking so long?
Maybe old man Corley got himself in trouble.
Yeah, maybe they took the old guy out back and worked him over the future? With a 2x4.
An appealing notion, but improbable.
And I'm sorry about telling this story, but we were talking about making a movie of this with MTV. Do you remember that? MTV wanted to put this on liquid television.
Yeah.
And I was in MTV in New York, and I was talking to a guy about it. And he was saying that he was playing this intro to the game, and that Mike Judge had walked by. Mike Judge was doing Beavis and Butthead at the time. And he walked by, and he stopped, and he walked back in. He listened. He's like, did that guy just say, whenever I smell asshole? And that's what I think of whenever I hear that line, and I had to tell that story. We probably can't use that story in the commentary, though. Now you know.
Sure you can.
Does this look like an escort service to you? You would be well compensated for your time, of course.
Not interested.
It's fairly obvious that you could use the money.
Listen, I said we're not for rent. The Polecats are not goons for hire.
Not even if it were Malcolm Corley's dying wish.
Rip Burger! That does it! I'm gonna...
Hold on there, Malcolm. If you don't mind, I'd like to step outside with Mr. Rip Burger for a little chat.
Excellent idea. And the doctor says he only has a few months to live.
That's bad news for all of us. He's not just
Damn.
A nice guy. He's also the last motorcycle maker in the country. What happens to Corley Motors if he dies?
Don't worry. I have a plan. And if you come to the show...
Rip Burger is damn ugly in the old version, but even more ugly in the nice version.
The Polecats are not thugs for rent. If you want to buy muscle, you should go find the Rottweilers.
The old man says it's the Polecats are nothing.
Then I guess it'll have to be nothing.
And that's your last word?
That's it.
Look out, Ben! Send us the music!
I'd like to make you just one final offer.
Oh. You got an achievement for that? Well, I didn't even do anything.
Bolas, take this coat and go get his motorcycle. We'll have to tie up this little 200-pound loose end. It'll need to look like an accident.
That stuffed shirt actually thinks I'll leave him in control of Corley Motors when I go. boy, is he in for a surprise.
Hey, where's Ben going?
Your colleague has decided to accept our generous offer after all. As a matter of fact, he's gone on ahead to scout out the route.
He did?
Well then, let's roll 'em, boys! Yahoo! Corbill, here we come!
Hmm. Okay. Ooh. PlayStation controls. Press A to play commentary. Alright.
I remember the dumbest things, like the back of that, the back of the bar where the dumpster is. I just remember telling Peter Chan to get rid of the ladder. Like, he had a ladder there that went up onto the roof, and that was part of the learning. Like, you can't put interesting things in adventure games because, like, the player's going to want to go up that ladder and climb up there, and so he had to paint it out. He was so mad about that. But, and I think of this room where we started talking about how did we do a game that stylized, do you remember this, Larry? Like, stylized, like, but not a cartoon for kids. Because we didn't want to go quote-unquote realistic, but we wanted to do something that was more adult. And remember, you guys talked a lot about Mike Mignola and Hellboy.
Yeah, we're looking at Hellboy stuff.
And how things disappeared into the blackness a lot. And so you can see in that in the bar, there's a lot up in the TV and the pipes and stuff. It just kind of disappears into nothingness.
Hmm. Oh, yeah, you can see, you can hear the sound quality difference, yeah.
I don't have anything.
That's right, the burning verb wheel.
Empty boxes. He really should flatten these, so they can be recycled. Nah, he can flatten his own boxes.
Ben Throttle there, caring about the environment.
So here, there's a puzzle where you kick open the door after this cutscene, right? You kick open the door.
Kick open the door was just like a kind of a character setting thing for us. We're like, we always talked about how, you know, Bernard Bernoulli and Day of the Tentacle, if he had to like get through a locked door and all he had was a bologna sandwich, that he would figure out a way of like putting the mayonnaise on the floor and sliding the bread under and then taking the toothpick and poking the key through the hole and dropping it in the point. And then Ben Throttle would just eat the sandwich and kick the door down. And that was like how we were like expressing character through puzzle design in these games.
Which is why this game is 2 hours long.
It's why it's a little shorter.
I know what happens if you use the bike, but I like the cutscene.
Some joker took my keys. I don't like that. Open up. I fixed your door. It was sticky.
Look, I don't want no trouble. Just leave me out of this mess.
And there's the bartender's name is Quahog. I don't know if that comes up ever in the game, but his name is always Quahog. Mm-hmm. Which is like from Moby Dick. It's how Queequeg misspells his own name when he signs into the log of the ship.
Whenever I do a search on it, I would always get Queequeg. I'm like, is that supposed to be? Because I remember you saying it was related to that. And then working with the animation team trying to do the high-res versions of all these characters, every time I got an email about it, it was spelled differently.
Yeah.
It's Quoog. It's Queeg.
Man, I wish they had a jukebox. Yeah, right.
Play.
What's this?
It's a big blobby gray shape. I was taking an art class.
That's one big fish.
Yep.
Good thing that's a badger.
Why?
Because if that were a dead polecat, I'd have to trash the place.
All right, let's talk to this friendly bartender.
Looks like you're out of customers,
Yeah, your gang took off with those well-dressed gentlemen. So what'll it be, Mac?
Where'd everybody head off to?
What am I, the cruise director? Maybe they're up on the Lido deck.
I think you're in on this whole bum deal.
Yeah, well, what are you gonna do about it?
This.
You know what might look better on your nose?
What?
The bar. Now don't mess around with me.
Alright, alright! I got your keys, but I don't know nothing. They had guns. They told me to stall you as long as possible.
Why?
I don't know. I don't know. I overheard them say something about an ambush up the road.
What else?
Nothing, nothing. Look, man, here are your keys, all right? Someone did say something about killing you and making it look like an accident.
They didn't do too good of a job there. But why ambush the Polegants? I'd better get moving.
All right.
And there's...
Yeah. So now, there you go. You don't actually have to use them, just use your bike. Yeah. Look at that. That's a big difference.
But they try.
Hey! Ain't you the A number one polecat honcho?
Yeah, and you're in my way.
Well, get used to it, bud. When the Rottweilers hit the road, we own it.
Look, I'm serious. Someone's ambushing the polecats.
Someone's ambushing the polecats? Oh, heavens! Whatever will we do?
That does it.
Come on, kitty! Let's get down!
Yeah! I shall show off with a wheelie! And screw mysteriously fall out just then. The end. Ben is dead.
Oh man, dream sequence.
I remember this scene was literally tossed together in about an hour. We need something in here after the wreck.
You mean lovingly crafted?
Lovingly, yes.
In an hour.
Sorry, is that what's supposed to be on the commentary about how much effort was put into these? A lot of it was we had such a tiny team and we're going, the whole thing will be fully animated. It'll be crazy.
Watching this, I'm realizing like after Day of the Tentacle, where we had just three full screen animations in the whole game. Like, what did we sit down and say, like, hey, this next game is going to be crazy, and we're going to have all these full screen animations the entire time?
Yeah, we said it was going to be a completely cinematic thing. Everything, there's going to be scenes.
Because I don't remember realizing what we were taking on in the beginning.
No, we had no
idea.
Which
is probably the special talent I have that lets me do with these games, which is to not think about what this is going to entail.
Because we would basically plan out the scene, and about the only thing I remember doing to try to keep it reasonable was saying, if we edit enough, no one shot will have that much animation in it. You know, just as the animation's getting complicated, cut to another angle, you know. Right. But still, the scene was going to last X amount of frames long. It's like somewhere in there, you're going to have to animate something. Yeah. So we just did a lot of fast cutting MTV style stuff. And we kept saying, well, if you cut to a close up of the face, you know, then not much is moving.
I mean, like, if you do a master shot and have a bunch of people doing stuff in it, that would take forever to animate. People picking up objects, putting them down, lip syncing. But if you cut to just someone's eyes moving slightly, it's more dramatic and it is less.
Yeah. So it was always like, you know, the guy that's swinging the wrench at the thing that's going to blow up, you'd get him to start to move, and then you'd show the reaction of the guy being surprised. Mm-hmm. And then you hear boom, and then you cut back in the little wisp is moving.
Hmm. Yeah, that's the thing. You know, you could take things for granted like this nowadays, that, you know, animation, movies, stuff like that, but back in 1995, didn't exist. They were still making stuff up as they went along. Anyway.
Who are you?
Maureen, remember? If that's too hard, maybe you should just stick with Mo.
Do you have a last name?
I prefer not to use it. What about you?
Same deal.
Then it's Ben and Mo forever, I guess.
Now, what was it? His official name is supposed to be Ben Throttle. Silly bit of trivia for you. But the reason why they never use it, really, in the game is partly because at the time those biker mice from Mars... And I think the surname of one of them was Throttle, and they didn't want to cause issues, so they kind of just left it out.
This an authorized Corley Service Center?
You could call this a Corley Service Center, but I don't have the official paperwork.
Ah, an illegitimate Corley operation.
I prefer to think of it as a renegade Corley operation.
Where'd you learn bikes?
I grew up working on them with my dad. One summer, we did nothing but restore this old hardtail together. I mean, we scrubbed every bolt until it shined. But he took off one day and he never came back. So I switched to toasters.
Hmm. I have to switch. I mean, geez, look at that. And then look at this. I love the beard. I love the fact his face is all sort of smooshed. And then... but then it's just sort of, wow. It's like... 20 times better.
You live in this town?
Well, Melonweed's not much of a town. What's left of it is sinking about a foot a year. People either learn to adjust, or they leave, which is fine with me.
Not a people person?
I'm just better with toasters, that's all. You seem more concerned with me than your bike.
How's it look?
It looks better than it did, but you gotta help me out. The front forks are wasted, so you'll have to get some new ones. And someone stole my welding torch. Can you believe that?
Yes.
I can't finish without one. And last but not least, I patched up your ruptured gas tank, but you're out of fuel and I don't have any.
Okay.
I gotta get out of this town, fast.
Trouble with the law?
Not in this county.
Then what's the hurry?
My gang's in trouble.
Polecats?
How'd you know that?
Big emblem on the back of your jacket.
They're headed for an ambush, so I gotta catch them.
We better get this bad boy back on the road then, huh?
I don't have any money to pay you with.
Hey, this one's free. I haven't touched anything besides a toaster for so long. Getting my hands on your hog has really been a pleasure.
Well, thanks.
Don't sweat it.
Where am I supposed to find all this stuff?
You can hack it, tough guy.
Where am I gonna find new forks?
Well, they don't have to be new, just not broken into little pieces. You could start by asking Todd in the trailer across the way. He runs the junkyard.
How am I supposed to find your torch?
I don't know. Set up a dragnet. Still can't believe someone would steal my torch. Who around here would do a thing like that?
Considering there's only one person around here called Todd, maybe you should try that.
Where's the gas?
Well, there's a whole tower full of it at the edge of town. I have this crazy, irrational intuition that tells me maybe it's worth checking out.
Actually, I think I can handle it.
Good.
Well, I'll let you get back to work.
Let me know if you need any aspirin or anything.
I just can't get over the difference. I mean, most of the background is pretty accurate, but it's just the level of detail on her especially. Go on in, we'll do this. Just because I love triggering.
Who's this?
Oh, that's me and my Uncle Pete. He took care of me after Dad split at this place he called the Mink Ranch. When he died, he left it to me.
You're a mink farmer?
Nah, that place went belly up long before he died. But I still go back there whenever I need to get away for a while.
Maureen got her name. Originally, the story had two twins that were the twin daughters of Malcolm Corley, and they're named Maureen and Tina after these two girls who lived in the dorm with me in college. And then we cut Tina. So. Sorry, Tina.
Oh, good. You're not dead yet. I might still get a quote.
Now this. And look, look. It's a nose. It's the mouth go. And that's just that miles better.
Chan does a lot of designs where you can see, like, the story of the town is that it's sunk. There's obviously right. A building that was here before and it just sunk, and they're just like, screw it, let's build another house on top of it. And they just build another one. Like a lot of he does a lot of double houses. There's some of that in Second House, like roofs upon roofs.
That's smart.
I heard you saved my life.
Yeah, but don't worry. I wasn't trying to. I was just looking for some nice roadside disaster photos, and you helped.
Who'd want a picture of me bleeding?
It's not the blood. It's the way you were, all twisted up like a pretzel.
Listen, I've got to stop an ambush.
Ambush? Really? Where?
Somewhere between here and Corville. My crew is escorting some VIPs to the Corley Motors shareholders meeting, and there's an ambush waiting for them somewhere up the road. I...
Yeah?
This is hard for me. I need...
Come on, man, spit it out!
Could you give me a ride in your car? I've got to stop this ambush.
You're right. We have to get to the ambush, all right. But I'm afraid I'm without wheels at the moment.
How did you get us here?
Hitched.
Well, I'd better be going.
All right, drive safe now.
I think you can't select it, but there's a car. Sneaky witch. Check out the mailbox.
It's empty. I don't want to hurt Moe's mailbox.
Aww. Sneaky girl.
Thanks for the lift. Now I got a quote for you.
Up yours, woman.
Hang on, I'm just... There we go.
This is a pretty ambitious game. Like, I feel like on every level we were just like...
It's a long conversation.
We got in way over.
Well, now, does anyone remember...
Well, I mean, I think we were thinking about things like, I was thinking about Road Warrior and Yojimbo, because Road Warrior, I just love the way, it's just dramatic, gritty story being told, yeah. like an opera almost, and then Yojimbo is just the stoic hero, you know, you've seen Yojimbo with the, Toshiro Mifune is like this really stoic main character who's not like a big tough guy who really shows off a lot, but he's really quiet and quiet until he goes and he goes and kills 20 samurai, you know, just really quickly. And Ben was really inspired by him. And then I got the screenplay for The Road Warrior somewhere. And in the first shot of it, Mad Max, like, he gets to a fork in the road. He doesn't know where to drive to. And he pulls over and he finds a wreck of a car. And he takes a bumper off of it and he throws it in the air. And wherever the bumper lands, he drives off that way, which is exactly how Yojimbo starts, with him doing it with a stick. And I was like, I knew it. I knew this is all one big part of this generalized... lone hero thing going
yeah
on.
We were looking at Clint Eastwood Man with No Name stuff too. Everybody squints like Clint.
Yeah, easier to animate, right?
Yeah, squint. Exactly.
Yeah.
I wonder who has a blowtorch.
Either someone's doing some welding down there, or we're talking about some very subcode wiring.
I have an electrician friend who yelled at me for using the firm term subcode wiring. He's like, that's not something electricians would ever say.
we lost a lot of electricians.
Yeah,
fans.
But, you know, Ben's not an electrician. What are you going to say? Today, the apocalypse.
Who's out there? Hey!
I'm trying to do my art in here, buddy.
I don't got time to...
I'm a friend of Moe's. I need... Listen, I didn't take no welding torch.
Of course you did.
You hear me? I'm no crook.
Yeah, yeah.
But get off my back already. What do you want?
This is important.
Not to me, you freaky-looking hood. Now bait it.
What you call me?
I got a guy coming to look at my yard. So-
Bang. Good night.
This is the first scene that you hear the Chitlin's Whiskey and Skirt song.
That's my favorite song.
Increased Chances. Yeah. Almost the great John Spiegel of Chicago. Friend of ours.
It creates a narrative problem in the game, though, which is that...
Post-apocalyptic.
We were always like, this is not a post-apocalyptic game. This is just an alternate reality, like an alternate world. Like, there's nothing about, there's been no nuclear devastation. This is just a gritty, you know, highway-based part of the country, you know, and in the future. And but a lot of people thought it was like, because it is inspired by Road Warrior a lot in terms of its cinematics and the way it tells the story. But there's nothing post-apocalyptic about it. But that song is all about nuclear, like it's a post-apocalyptic song. And so it kind of feeds into that. So
it's good to create false rumors, don't you think?
Yeah, exactly. Remember this was one of our big things was changing the interface so we get a full screen game this time around as opposed to Data Tentacle. You had to look up and down. But in this game, we wanted you... There's a theory that, like, people... You should have the interface where people's eyeballs are, and their eyeballs on the cursor, so let's make the interface pop up on the cursor. And I remember that... I hadn't seen that a lot. I think at the same time, you guys over at Lucas Learning were doing... Remember the Secret Project? The Secret Library Archive Project? There was a... You guys were doing one where the interface popped up near the cursor?
Yeah.
But... I'm telling you, that was cutting edge, you guys. Cutting edge cursors.
Okay. Yoink.
That's my welding torch. How'd you get it?
Oh, it was just lying around.
A pair of forks.
Oh, the smile.
Gas, and we're set.
Chanda.
Yeah. Okay. Right. Now I have to go here, don't we? Because I need this lock.
Off the side. Oh, this is cool. The first scene we did.
This is the first thing we ever wired up in the game?
Yeah, we did this one specifically for, was it CES or whatever else. We had to get it done, and we had just... the assets for this.
That cracks me up that we made like a two-room puzzle for CES. Did we do a special version of Ben? Because like he's all darkly
black.
We didn't have dynamic lighting back then, did we? Right?
No.
Like nowadays we'd be painted with a certain color that we would like tune up and down. But here we must have painted a whole another 3D we had in this game.
Was that the CES, Tim, where we had that guy on the motorcycle out in front of the booth?
I don't remember.
Pretending to be Ben Throttle.
I didn't know. Did we have a booth babe, dude?
We had a booth dude, and like all us ladies were swooning.
I just remember looking at the pictures, thinking that guy
was a hunky man.
We all wanted to go take a picture with him.
Yeah. Looks nothing like someone.
Did I even get to go to that CES?
I don't know.
I don't remember seeing any of this. Tell me about it.
Well, it was just a little, you know, booth in the back, but then there was a guy with a motorcycle right out front, and he was totally drawing people in.
Oh.
Maureen is the. Kath Soucie does the voice. She has a lot of cartoons. You look at the credits for almost any cartoon you're watching. Kath Soucie will show up. She does a great job with Maureen's voice, and she came back later on Brutal Legend and did Lita Halford.
Okay. What's that going to do with anything? Yeah, come on. Let's pop this here. Right. Now, this puzzle took me a while because you don't... It's one of the few things in the game, you can't highlight it. Basically, you have to set the alarm off and run over here and hide. But there's no indication that that's what you're supposed to do. So what I'm going to do is do this first.
I get to save fire before you do that, Floyd.
Sorry, boss. I got excited.
That's right, Floyd. What's your trigger finger? Right, let's go back. Obviously, it wasn't an achievement attached to that. Run, Ben, run! Hi.
Remain where you...
Hey, where is he?
I told you, I nailed him last time.
Well, who set off the alarm, Floyd?
Maybe someone is just fooling with us.
Oh, it's him. It's that guy you keep missing.
Well, if you could hold this thing still while I'm shooting.
I'm going down for a closer look.
I don't see nobody. He must have run away.
Nah, we would have seen him running from the air. He must be hiding up in the tower.
We got
maybe he's hiding behind that thing.
Let's
over
go
there.
Up and get him.
That thing that we didn't bother checking. No, okay, that's the same thing. Do 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 do. Oh, not a lock. There we go. Now again, this took me a little while because it was quite new. How do you get fuel out of something?
Hey, who's that down there in the yard?
It's him. Get him.
Where?
Over there.
Quick.
You go around the other side and we'll have him cornered.
Where'd he go? Let's call it quits, huh, boss?
No. Let's call on reinforcements.
Hardly the sharpest tack in the tool.
Oh, good. You get this from the gas tower?
Not exactly.
Just a pair of new forks and we're on the road.
Alright. To the junkyard. This is of course quite obvious.
This was one of the first puzzles we designed for the game, and I have fond feelings about it. I don't know if everyone likes this puzzle, they might hate it. But this game is not gonna have a lot of complicated inventory combining puzzles where you collect up a whole bunch of stuff and then put together an inventory. It's going to be mostly all on the screen. So, like, here you come up, and there's a rope, there's a chain you can pull, and it opens the gate, but then you can't keep it open when you run through it. And the trick is to do something counterintuitive. You have to lock the gate. And I was so happy with that because it was all just right on the screen. You didn't have one inventory item, which is a lock. But then again, some people, like all puzzles, hate that puzzle. So, you know, I like it.
So what do? You lock it.
Junk.
There's my car, my actual car.
Oh, there.
So,
that's the Timmobile?
Oh, yeah.
Do you still have that car?
It's in a garage in Reading. Because I was driving, I bought the car from my dad, which is his 69 Le Mans, which is, it looks like a GTO. It's a really fun car to have. And then I go at lunch one day with a bunch of LucasArts co-workers in it.
Oops. I'll go back home.
There's my car, my actual car.
Oh, there.
So that's
the Timmobile?
Oh, yeah.
Do you still have that car?
It's in a garage in Reading. Because I was driving, I bought the car from my dad, which is his 69 Le Mans, which is, it looks like a GTO. It's a really fun car to have. And then I go at lunch one day with a bunch of LucasArts co-workers in it. Before I started it, someone was like, "Do you smell gas?" And I was like, "No, you're silly." And I started it, and then boom!
That was me and Michelle Harrell.
Yeah, and And you remember, like, black smoke came out of the defroster bin?
It's a convertible.
Yeah, we had John. I was like, get out of the car. jumped out. And I run to this jewelry store to use 911. And secretly, I've been wanting to call 911 all my life, right? Like, you'd be like, oh, someday I'm going to have to call them.
And they're like, then, you're at the jewelry store. It's a robbery. What's going on?
And I ran back to the car, and there was a pool of fire underneath the car. And there were already fire people there, like firefighters there, because I was across the street from the fire department. I could have run to the fire department to bring them over. And anyway, they put out the fire, and then it was really bad. There's bubbles embedded in the windshield from just the heat. Jeez. And you guys go back to the office. So you guys went back to the office while I hung around with the tow truck. And you told Peter Chan what had happened. And so Peter Chan happened to be painting this art. And so he's like, well, I guess Tim's car is toast. I'll put it in the junkyard. And he painted my beautiful car in the junkyard.
That was when you actually had to run somewhere to make a phone call.
Yeah. Yep.
Oh, wakey wakey.
Ooh, fire damage. Forget about it.
Right, so this dog's a pain in the ass.
Here, Poochie Pooch. Pooch. Bon appetit, mutt.
Right, let's go up. Now, this takes forever. This doesn't go in the right car. There we go. Yeet. Yeah. The parts pile is the one on top.
Nice forks. Where'd you find them?
Right next to the knives and spoons.
Well, that's it. Wait outside for a minute and I'll finish her up. I'm working on a surprise.
I hate surprises.
All right, here she comes.
Yeah.
Am I cool or what?
You're amazing. I should crash that thing every day. So what's the surprise?
Oh, just your average everyday pre-regulation destroyer class solid fuel recoil booster.
You're serious?
Yes.
But only the vultures.
Did you notice the tattoo foreshadowing on Maureen's? She's got a little bit of a vulture's tattoo, because it's like a big... spoilers, I won't say, in case you're playing this game and you don't know. But there's some foreshadowing right there.
By the way, I had somebody contact me a couple months ago asking for the definitive version of the vulture's tattoo because she was going to get...
Oh, my God.
Wow. And I was feeling terrible because she's going to ink it on her, and I'm like, I don't know. There's the pixelated version, but it's so messed up. And then there's a sketch that I have, but it's not the final one because I think trying to translate it to pixels and then shrinking it down, a lot of that didn't read. So I'm trying to figure out, I don't know what to tell her, which is... official one, because it's kind of... I just sent her a bunch of stuff and said, take your best guess. I don't know.
All right, look lively. He's a sneaky one.
This time he ain't getting past us.
See him?
Nope.
Keep looking.
You distract these bozos.
Fun things about sound design for this game is Michael and Peter and I would occasionally have lunch with Gary Rydstrom, who was a sound designer up at Lucasfilm and Skywalker Sound, and he did the sound for Titanic and Jurassic Park and Saving Private Ryan. This is one of the very top sound designers in the world, and just having conversations with him. That's when we decided to really record a lot of the sounds originally. Go out in the field with mobile recording rigs, and then also combining things creatively. You know, people all talk about it today, but back then it was a little bit new, I think, in the games industry, to say, you know, combine the Lion Roar with the kickstart of the bike, for example.
Yeah, this was definitely the first game we did it on, because playing Dot recently, I was like, I think these all came off a CD. I think all the sound effects in Dot, there's a lot of
we were lucky to even have a
cartoon sound effects library, and then immediately with Throttle, it's like you started the bees in the jar.
Oh yeah.
I always talk about the bees in the jar because I always thought that was so funny that like you got four motorcycle sounds out of like the four different motorcycle tribes, the gangs in the game. You had the bees in a jar that were slowed down a lot for the Rottweilers and sped up a lot for the cavefish.
Yeah.
And so do you remember the components of like Ben's bike?
Well, Ben's, we hired a biker from San Francisco who had a Harley chopper.
Very customized.
Very not painted. It was all just sort of nickel colored and straight pipes, which basically were like cannons going off every stroke. Oh, and there's just so many stories about that whole recording session.
He set off car alarms in his neighborhood when he drove through it.
Set off car alarms. And he was the real deal, too. I mean, he had a couple bikes, but he brought that one up to Marin, and we had a whole long recording session. Mm-hmm. And that ended up being Ben's bike.
Wait, I want to hear about how you got the bees in the jar.
Oh, I think that was a library
that
sound.
That actually was a library sound, but we used a lot of sort of
I thought you captured all the bees. Yeah. It must have taken all day.
I remember Gary Rydstrom came around and actually looked at the game when we were working on it.
That's right. He liked a couple things. Yeah, in fact, he complimented. I had looped a tiger growl and looped it for an element when the bike is just idling. And he goes, nice loop. That's one of the things you just
I thought there was a donkey bang and a jet engine and a line roar. So those are the other biker gangs, not Ben's bike?
In Ben's bike, the main thing was the lion when he kicks it over. The lion roar with the sound of a bike being kicked over. The purring, it was not a purr, but it's kind of like a throaty growl of the tiger for when it's just idling.
Anyway. So we're going to distract those guys to get past.
You hear that? He's back at the gas tower.
He's got a lot of nerve, that piece of trash.
Let's get him.
All units, follow me.
Yep, definitely not the sharpest tack in the drawer. Oh, look, there's that biker down there. That can't be him.
Ben, how'd you get behind us?
Where are the suits?
Corley's making a pit stop. He has a bladder the size of a thimble, man.
Ripberger?
Haven't seen him in a while. Ben, man, what's the deal? Did you find something up the road? Are we headed for trouble?
No. We're in it.
Put my head in a basket, 'cause I'd had a tank full. When she blew my gasket, I surely was thankful. Till I head for the skies up above. It's a woman with wheels that I love.
Come on, old man. I gotcha. Now, do something incriminate, like ambush somebody. Aha, the plot thickens.
And they're moving at one frame a second.
You shouldn't have laughed at me in those board meetings, Malcolm.
What a psycho.
Gotcha. Hey, look what I found in the bushes. What is that?
It's a chokehold. Come here and I'll demonstrate.
It's got a camera.
I'll get her.
No, Nestor will take care of her. You have an important engagement with the rest of the Corley family.
Right.
But don't forget to destroy that camera.
Yeah.
Now then, Malcolm, how about one for the road?
Corley.
Ben!
That's pretty accurate, actually, that.
This Ripberger couldn't wait for natural causes. Just like him to hit a man when his fly's down.
Ripberger did this to you?
Yeah, he knew I was dying, and he knew that my will would put him out of a job. He wants to take over Corley Motors, Ben. Sell it off to foreigners, lay off workers, start making minivans.
Not
you
minivans.
You understand me? Minivans!
No!
You gotta hurt him for me, Ben. Promise me you'll hurt him bad.
I promise.
I want my daughter to take over the company.
You have a daughter?
Yeah, and she's a real mechanical genius,
Ben. I wonder who that
rebuilt her first carburetor when she was four. I used to call her the diaper dynamo.
Important piece of
information. Find my daughter, Ben. Find Marine.
Marine?
Of course.
I feel like we were watching, started watching a lot of Hong Kong movies at this point, because there's a lot of that, like, reflection in the toaster.
Right.
You see the bad guys coming is taken right out of either Hong Kong movies or Hard Target, which was the Jean-Claude Van Damme movie.
All right.
We saw right when we were making this.
Also, easier to animate the villain really small in a reflection.
Yeah, and wiggly in a toaster. I wonder how many people say they use Hard Target. Basically, this is Hard Target, the game. And
I think only two people were inspired by Hard Target, Van Damme and Tim.
Nestor, what's that moving over there by that pile?
I don't know, Rip, but I think that pile is Bolas.
Yes, now I remember. You're the smart one, aren't you?
There's Moe's shack.
Double fade there.
But I don't see the memo. Maybe I beat him. On second thought, maybe I didn't.
Chan does a lot of...
Yeah, we're done that.
Looks like someone searched this place in a hurry. Nothing left but debris, except for that smashed-up camera. Back's open. No film inside. Mo said she didn't have a camera. Here's Mo's picture of her and her Uncle Pete at his mink ranch. She said she went there whenever she needed to get away for a while. That's pretty much my only lead right now.
Yeah, still there. Okay.
One of the really fun things.
Turn around. Let's go, Daddy-O.
That's it. I remember we didn't want to talk about, at one point the schedule had slipped, but I didn't want to be talk about how much because I was too scared to think about it. And you're like, do you want to know what the budget is? I'm like, no. And I was like, what is it? It was like, it's $1 million. And it was and we had like gone from Monkey Island, which was I think was $200,000, and just had never conceived of money like that before. And like, this game is, it's the first one. It's like, it's $1 million.
You could only whisper the
I remember breaking that mark and everybody talking about like, holy crap.
$1 million.
I remember spending countless hours just staring at the budget. Where I'd like have to put in the actuals for the month and then based off of that project how the rest was gonna change and add more months and more dollars and
hey, killer.
What?
Hey, it's cool. Your secret's safe with me.
What secret?
Haven't you been watching the news?
Once again, our top story tonight, Malcolm Corley, owner of Corley Motors, was found dead at a rest stop just outside the town of Melonweed. Apparently, the benevolent patriarch and CEO was viciously beaten about the head and neck, savagely and without mercy. Police have arrested a notorious outlaw biker gang known as the Polecats.
No.
With the exception of their leader, who is still at large. Roadblocks have been set up along Highway 9 in an effort to apprehend this dangerous and violent criminal.
We've been set up. Roadblocks suck. I shouldn't have left the gang there.
Hey, I don't want to hear anything about it. You ain't making me an accessory after the fact.
Just lay low, man.
What I don't understand is, why does the newsreader feel like he needs to go really close like this and go like that? Whenever he sort of wide-eyed and very close, whenever he sort of says something important.
Over here!
Who said that?
Joe, you remember the scum debug key?
The scum debug key, no. What was the scum debug key?
Wasn't it Control D or something? Matilda?
Oh, after Matilda?
You type in like Control D Matilda on the keyboard, and they would turn on all the scum jump codes and all the...
Oh, I wonder if that shipped in the game.
Hey. It did.
It did? Yeah. Don't try that at home. Control D, the what?
It's like Control D, and then you type in Matilda.
Control D. Hey. Don't do it.
Control D? That doesn't work.
Hey! Ben, no time to talk.
You know, it's dank in there, but I can't remember a better sleep.
You gotta help me. Go find my editor in Corville. Tell him I took pictures of the Corley murder.
You got pictures?
Yeah, but some thug took my camera.
So you don't have any pictures?
Well, I tracked the guy to Melonweed, but I'm not going near the place. They'd kill me. Get my editor. He's gotta get me out of this. Take one of these fake IDs to get through the roadblocks. My career is riding on those pictures. Help me, Ben. You're my only hope.
Star Wars reference.
Oh, don't worry. I owe you one. If Miranda's thug is the same one that trashed Moe's place, that could be Miranda's camera I saw there. But then, who's got the film?
And, by the way, this is not set... This is set in the future, where we still use film and cameras. Are we talking to this guy?
Look, let me tell you what happened.
I told you I don't want to get involved.
I can do that.
Not gonna happen.
Let me show you how to do that.
Not gonna happen.
Seem to have a lot of time on your hands. Not to mention Nixon's scratches. Am I distracting you? That's your truck out front. I need a ride.
I look like a cabbie to you. Get lost. They're not letting anyone through that roadblock anyway.
Not even truckers?
They turned me around, said police business only. Pigs.
Good talking to you. Friendly folks you get in here.
Damn, it's not what you'd call an I'm okay, you're okay person.
Ah, shut your hole, Quahog.
See? Alright.
Here.
What's that?
Fake federal investigator ID. Could be of some use at one of those roadblocks. Ever hear of this place?
Hey, he just took a knife in it.
Eat Mink Ranch.
I remember there used to be some sort of weasel plantation or something up the road. Down Highway 9 on the other side of them damn roadblocks. I used to pick up mink meat there real cheap and sell it to school lunch programs. That was a good scam.
So how about a ride? What if they search the back and find my bike?
It's buried in a pile of concentrated fertilizer powder. Trust me, no one's gonna dig through that crap. Now you're gonna ride
right, your bike's gonna stink. Compartment.
The engine compartment?
Hey, I smuggle stuff in there all the time, and most of it's worth more than you. So stuff your carcass in there quick, and we might hit that mink dump by morning.
Hope you're better with a stick shift than you are with a knife.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Smells like he's got a fuel leak. I love engine fires.
Sorry, sir. Only police vehicles beyond this point.
I'm with the feds, Chump. Check it out.
Huh? What's this about?
Undercover agricultural sting operation.
What's in the back?
Fertilizer.
All right, move along.
Hope you rubes get your man.
Problem with your truck?
Loose hose and nothing big. I already pulled your bike out. It's sitting right over there. Well, nice knowing you. Gotta hit the road, you know.
Uh-oh. He did have a fuel leak, and he took my fuel line to fix it. That trucker's gonna die for what he did.
That's right, you don't mess with the guy's bike. So not a biker's anyway. Biker's bike.
I remember Casey was Tim Wrangler.
Tim Wrangler. But this wasn't, it was Grim where you were like listed as pre-production.
I was the production manager on Full Throttle.
Okay.
Although I love the name of the title producer, I was really disappointed.
Wait, who was the producer? Did we have,
well, didn't have a producer.
He's got a project leader.
And actually when we did have producers, I remember that didn't help so much because it would be somebody that was on like half time or less.
It was me and Wayne splitting all the projects down the middle.
As producer, you mean?
the very beginning, yeah.
Tucker can, if we still don't respect producers around here, still treat them like, right?
I'm Tim Wrangler now. Good work with that.
That's a more prestigious title than producer.
I don't walk.
Yeah. Remix. Sorry.
I don't have anything.
Hey.
Velvet Underground just wouldn't have worked for this.
Oh, yeah. So originally we were trying to get music. We were thinking about getting licensed music. And we talked to some record companies, and they offered us for free the entire catalog
of the
Velvet Underground.
Which was such cool music.
Which is, yeah, who she loved. But I was like, I don't know if this fits the biker theme. And then also, like, The Clash was one of them offered to, because they were shipping a box set of these things.
Yeah, I think The Clash was. But
and
they
the
were
one we wanted
too,
was,
yeah.
We wanted Soundgarden. Right. I wanted Soundgarden because they had a song called Kickstand.
Right.
And the set in the Kickstand, and that song Kickstand was so perfect for it. So, should I tell the story? We went down to L.A.
Yes.
Me and Jack Morrison went down to L.A. to go to A&M Records to try and get them to give us... And we hadn't done any licensed music, really, at all, except for, Star Wars music. And we showed the game to them. We showed them the CES demo with the gas siphoning and stuff. And it was these young executives there, like, this is really cool. We really like it. And then, the big guy showed up, and I think he was, either A or M.
I recall the story being Mr. M.
Mr. M came in, and he sat down, and the younger guy was like, okay, Tim, why don't you tell him all about the game? And Mr. M was like, no, I want to hear it from you. Tell me why you thought this was a good idea. And so he was putting his own guy on the ringer, why'd you bring me in this meeting? And we talked about it. And actually, they were kind of into it until... when Jack was talking, he realized that we weren't going to pay them any money. We just wanted to get the song. We were trying to explain that it was going to be...
exposure for
them. Yeah.
Hmm. Oops. Put this open.
Junk. And a hose I can use on my bike. I don't think Mo would mind if I borrow them.
I love the sequence. We'll be right back.
took my booster fuel. Why is she running from me? She must think the whole world's against her. I think I know how that feels. That does it. He's dead. That sign. That means I'm in cavefish territory. Cavefish.
Whoops.
This cargo is worthless. We have been tricked, my brothers. Back to the cave.
The place looks deserted. Maybe the boss was wrong and she ain't coming here.
She's coming. We just got here first.
That means all we have to do is sit here and wait.
Yeah, so where were we with 3D? Like, 3D had already entered the world of games, right? But we were like, no, we love 2D stuff, but we have all these vehicles we have to make.
Dark Forces was just before this, right? Or just, it was...
It was concurrent.
It was concurrent.
It shipped around the same time.
That's right.
Because we technically shared a wrap party.
And that was sort of knocking off Doom to some extent.
Yeah. It was. It had 3D.
So was Rebel already happening? Because we had a 3D department. There was like three guys.
Yeah.
I think that's why we had it. What them work was for the Rebel Assault stuff.
Yeah, I think so. Mm-hmm. And then, we were talking about there's no way we can draw. Like, we were looking at all the... reference material from that anime film Akira, all the motorcycles were like, there is no way we can draw this stuff by hand. But then we were trying to figure out how do we get it to look 2D and mm-hmm. just compressing the heck out of the palette mm-hmm. and simplifying it.
This was a...
I guess they probably didn't have the cartoon renderers back then, right?
No, we didn't have cel shading or anything.
No. So it's
I remember there was a big struggle was trying to get it to actually match.
Yeah, so we were just trying to limit the palette, and then we had the... We had the 3D Ben on the bike, and then we would draw over it.
Right, hang on. I'll just do this, and then I'll say something. My bike! Okay, now this one action took me forever to find out about. I should look at a guide. I think it was in Games Master magazine to actually tell me what I had to do.
What a mess!
We pick up some fertilizer.
Maybe I'll just take a little.
It's a weapon. Because for the longest time, I didn't know about what needed to happen here. Let's go get part one and then we'll get an explanation of what we need to do. Hello, boys. Chase me.
Look at him run.
Come on, boys. Come get some fertilizer.
Whoosh.
It was Nestor's fault.
Get in quick. I have a plan. We're going to lure the Corley women out of hiding with a bike.
Boss, she already has a bike.
Yes, but this one she worked on with her father. It's an emotional thing. Don't try to understand. Now hurry.
Now this is the area where we were originally going to have the whole Ricky Myron section, right?
We were jumping over. Yeah, a gorge. We do have that here with the gorge you jump over.
No, but there was the stunt show and the whole Ricky Myron character stuff.
Ricky Myron, by the way, is a kid I went to. I was in fourth grade. Oh, yeah. And we're on the playground, and I had this rock, and I, for no reason at all, I want to see how high I could throw this rock in the air. And I threw it as high as I could, and it came down, and it hit Ricky Myron in the head. And he was like, why'd you do that? And I was like, you know what? Someday I'm going to make you a star. I'm going to, no.
Put you in the game.
I'll make it up to you.
I'm going to put you in the game, and then I'm going to cut you out of the game.
Yep. You're going to be a reference, but you're going to be a great daredevil.
Lots of interesting backstory, because it was the stuff we cut. Remember, because the game was getting so huge, and we're like, we'll never finish this. Mm-hmm. And I think there was that and one other section. We were looking for stuff to cut, and everything was too interconnected to everything else. And we're like, we can't cut anything except the Ricky Myron section. That's kind of its own piece.
Maureen.
Ricky Myron's infamous gorge jump. Tightrope walkers, hang gliders, human cannonballs. Many have tried to cross the mighty Cuyahoga Gorge, and many have failed. Except for Ricky Myron, the Flying Torch, who jumped the gorge on a stock Corley motorcycle. It was later uncovered that he had modified his Corley with a pre-regulation destroyer-class solid fuel recoil booster and an automotive hover lift. Myron said he would gladly replicate the jump to clear his name, but his special ramp was stolen by a mysterious truck hijacking motorcycle gang. Recoil booster and a hover lift, eh? Thanks for the tip, Rick. You're right, though. I'll need that ramp.
So there you go. That's basically a shopping list. Now, we've already got one of those items. Just gotta go and get it. Nope, not taking that exit. There we go. Let's just see it in old Dart style. Bike.
Looks okay for an aftermarket part.
All right. Now he's got the mine mode. Nope. Whoosh. What did that happen? Where'd it go? Yeah! Onto the mine road, yeah! Dum da dum da dee 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 dee. Now it should be Father Talk first. It's always Father Talk. Here he is. So he's basically the guru. He's gonna tell us what to do.
Father Talk. I haven't seen you since you retired from the Polecats.
Hey, Ben. How's my gang doing?
That's a long story. What are you doing out here?
Well, retirement's pretty boring, Ben. So I thought I'd come out to the old mine road and look for trouble.
You're picking fights?
That's what the old mine road's for, son.
Father Tort, I need your help. The gang's in jail and the law.
Ben, I'm not the leader of the Polecats anymore. You are. Can't you see I'm on permanent vacation?
Any fighting tips, Tork?
Ah, Ben, who's tougher than you?
The vultures are quick, and they're nuts.
The ones with those boosters are hard to whip. Just remember, Ben, it's not about muscle, it's about timing.
Those Rottweilers are ugly suckers.
They're none too bright either. I'm sure you can handle them.
What's up with those cavefish, man?
Watch out, Ben. They're not out here for sport. They hijack big rigs. It's part of their religion. Don't get in their way. They're blind, cold-hearted killers.
How do the cavefish ride if they're blind?
Well, they're only blind because they wear those special goggles to shield their sensitive cave-dwelling eyes. Special sensors in the goggles pick up the dots in the road and other large objects and landmarks to help them navigate. Kind of trippy, huh?
You know any way around Cuyahoga Gorge?
Around it? It's miles and miles long, Ben. What's the matter? Don't like bridges?
It blew up.
Ooh, sorry I missed that. Well, you could jump it, like Ricky Myron. Cavefish got his ramp in their hideout, you know.
Where is the cavefish hideout exactly?
Somewhere on this road. The entrance is totally invisible unless you got those weird cavefish specs. Can't talk anymore, Ben. Eating too many bugs.
Well, take it easy, Father.
Give him hell, Polecat.
So yeah, you gave a few useful hints there. Now we need to make some weaponry. Now, who's this guy? Ah, okay, it's not good.
I see you come for a lesson in pain. Pay close attention. This will hurt. Is that all the pain you can dish out?
I need a chainsaw. Yeah, there I go. Bye! It's always a bit random which one you get first. Aha. Now this is going to be the guy with the recoil booster. Can't do anything to him.
Say there, is that a pre-regulation destroyer class solid fuel recoil booster you have there?
Why, yes it is. Ta-da!
Chase me. Sorry, couldn't help myself. Right, okay, we should take this out of this guy fairly easily. He does have a chain.
Hey, there's the sound of you driving over a rough road here.
Steve, I remember you were duly hard on me to get that sound right of the tire going over those reflectors in the center of the road. And it's true, it makes that sound. We all know that sound. It's like, yeah. It sort of sounds like puck, you know, puck, 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 puck. And I have to admit, I had a really hard time making that sound. Finally, one time I was just driving and holding my arm out the window of my truck with a microphone and running over those things. I don't know if I ended up using those, but it was a tough sound to make to get it right. Oh, Tim, chainsaw. I threw a party at my house, which was up in the woods. In the house,
oh, yeah.
You know? And it was in the middle of a forest.
And we couldn't get to it.
And it had a long driveway that went through the forest.
Right.
And we had had a terrible...
Oops.
terrible storm, and it was pitch dark, and the first person to arrive at my party was Tim, driving alone, and he came up to a fallen tree across the driveway, and I emerge with a chainsaw running in my hand, and go walking up to Tim.
And a mask made of human flesh.
And I go walking up to Tim, and you were genuinely scared. Because he had read about stuff like this.
up in the woods of Nicosia.
Yeah. No, that guy's got
that party.
Yeah, it was
fun. Star Wars Rebel. That was a good party. The tattoo on his...
So anyway, like I was saying, I could never figure out how to get the plank, because you need the plank to get the cavefish, and you couldn't defeat the guy because he was too strong.
Yeah, where is this place? It's just like a circle of bikers randomly driving.
Well, it's like Highway 9. Actually, I wonder if there's a highway called Highway 9 on the way down. There's like Santa Cruz that bikers love. It's an actual like biker road where bikers go on a lot, and there's a lot of biker bars on the way and stuff. So that's real. That's right out of the pages of California history.
Is that 17 that you're talking
about? It's off of 17. Or it's the mountain road that you would take next to 92 and Highway 1.
Lead divers.
Where's the chain going? I lost the chain. Or did I not get hit? Then I read, get the fertilizer. Yeah, there's a chain. Get the fertilizer, and then you can take the people out that aren't wearing glasses. Then you can get the chainsaw and pretty much take out everybody. The only person you can't take out is the cavefish, because you need the plank. So I got the recoil booster, which I'll get with the chain. Here he is. And I got the hover lift thing. I could never figure out how to get into the cavefish.
What's wrong? Lead divers?
Nope.
That should have a couple of good boosts left in it.
Aha. Another hot wheeler. Is he the plank one? Yes, he is. Never change, it just makes it so easy.
Good.
Bye. Yeah. Plank time. Hopefully the cavefish is right about now. Ah, gonna hit it just right. Woo! Stick your head up, cottontail. Damn it! There we are. Oh, come on! You gotta hit him when his head's up. For some reason, it was harder to do that one. Okay, we'll just go through these guys again. Shouldn't be very far. Who's this guy? Ah, that's the generic dude. Hello. Choppy choppy! Bye! Ha ha ha! Woo-hoo. Come on, cavefish. Come on, cavefish. Oh, I don't want a rot wheeler. Hello again. Remember me? Ah, here we go again. Let's try this again. Oh, come on, I nearly hit him. There we go, got him. Let's do it. Put them on. exit. Right. It's right after one of the exits, but I can't remember which one. Exit, exit, cave. There we go. There we go.
When we were in the end of QA, and Tim decided to go play pool one night in San Francisco. This was before cell phones.
Uh-huh.
And something came up, and I had to find Tim and bring him back. I think it was for the bunnies. And because there was a bug that had to be fixed, and we had to ship this game. And so all I knew was that Tim had gone to play pool in San Francisco.
Well, I didn't have any work to do.
Right.
So you're basically thumbing through the yellow pages.
I had the phone book, and I called every pool hall in San Francisco looking for him.
This makes me sound like a totally different person.
I know. But he wasn't like in juke any. Joint. He wasn't in any of them. So then I'm like, okay. So the last pool hall, I said, okay, so maybe he's in a bar with a pool table. Can you tell me the name of a bar that has a pool table? And he did. And then I looked that up, and I called that. And then when he wasn't there, I just kept doing that. Until finally,
are you kidding me?
Finally, I found him in some bar with a pool table.
Oh my goodness!
And
it was a kilowatt.
When he picked up the bar phone, he was terrified because he was like, "How did you find me?"
Actually, awesome. I don't remember. This is crazy. I can't believe you found me by calling random bars. It makes me sound way cooler than I am. But what could I have done? I wasn't programming.
I want to know how she described it.
Actually, I did program for the bunnies.
It was something that you had to make a call on something.
It was my actual bug.
Yeah. It was either your bug or you had to make a decision right then and there as to what we were going to do.
Bunnies in or out.
Right, let's get this done. So if you notice, it knocks off one of the actual cat's eyes. And that's an important thing to remember because it's basically... something you need to do to stop them chasing you. See you, suckers.
I'm done with these boys.
See you, sucker.
Now this is the area where we were originally going to have the whole Ricky Myron's.
So, let's get this done. So yeah, never got that far, then we finally got that far. It's like, yes, finally. Then we got to Corville, and it's like a whole new ball game. Do it. Go. a guitar for you there. Probably can't see much of it. Nice. Right, what does it say here?
Yeah, you remember how we used to get, how we got the rock and roll to sound so good in the game?
Oh, we just deliberately distorted it?
Yeah, we turned it up so that, we turned it up because of the low sample rate, we turned it up so it was about, I think about 50% too hot.
Clipping.
So it was clipping, so all the waveforms were being chopped.
Right.
For all you audio geeks out there. it's a real no-no. But it sounded good. The best way to do it for that particular sound.
Well, since we're talking about Smush, which originated, I believe, with Rebel Assault, right, with Vince, in an earlier incarnation at least, and Vince liked to do everything himself, and we were a little miffed in the sound department because we found out that he had dubbed the Star Wars main theme himself using a boombox.
Right.
And the headphone output.
Right.
Right. So, you know, it more geeky audio stuff, but basically a headphone signal is an amplified signal, right, to drive the headphones. And he put that right into the computer, to the Sound Blaster card, and sampled it. And it sounded really big and huge and over the top. And we said, Vince, let people do this who know how. So we couldn't get it to sound as good as he had. No matter what we did. And then I finally realized the only way to get it to sound better, or even just a little better than what he had, was to deliberately
clip it and
overdrive the analog signal and overdrive everything.
And of course now we have digital. What's all the sound? Hang on.
Those weapons were out of weight.
In other words, got rid of all those weapons, don't need them.
I want to talk about Roy Conrad because we listen to a lot of audition tapes for this game, and everyone you tell them they're going to be a biker does this really yummy that, like tough. That was my tough guy voice. Like, trying to be like super Tasmanian tough. Devil. And it always came through as trying to be tough, and I didn't like any of them. And then we heard Roy's voice, and it is really deep and tough sounding, but he's kind of gentle about it, and there's something about the fact that he's not trying to sound tough that just makes us love it all right away. But the second he started talking, we're like, yeah, Ben.
Such a great voice.
And
he looked nothing like the character.
No, he looked like a dad, like a gentle,
kindly old fatherly dad.
Yeah, if you actually Google him, Roy Conrad, you'll see what I mean. Knock, knock.
I'm here for the shareholders' meeting.
Mr. Ripperger has postponed the meeting until Mr. Corley's murderers are apprehended. All the shareholders were notified.
Yeah. Well, I haven't checked my voicemail lately, Mac.
All right.
Souvenirs here!
There was a local radio DJ named Alex Bennett, who was a big fan of Day of the Tentacle.
Yeah.
And he was a fan of ours. We got him to do the voice of the stadium announcer.
That's right.
That was funny. He was like the Howard Stern before Howard Stern, as I think he would say.
Mm-hmm. Didn't we get him to do some sort of PR thing on a show?
I got to go on the show and promote.
Wasn't he at the...
He was at the rap party. He was an institution in San Francisco radio.
Yes, he was.
KMEL and all these different stations.
Live 105, yeah.
105, yeah. He was a big deal, and then he got his voice in the game.
Okay.
Fill our handy beverage hats with your drink of choice. Sure, sure. Take it for a spin. Just don't go out of range. Souvenirs to remind you of your special Smashatorium adventure. Buy your kids a bunny so they'll shut up on the long drive home.
Looks like it's getting weak.
Oh, great. You killed the battery. Don't be a cheap jerk. Buy something. What can I get you?
Why are the lights down here?
We got a demolition derby tonight. First prize is a vintage curly hardtail, completely restored by the old man himself. Yep.
What's this big arena doing way out here?
Corley built the Smashatorium so his employees could have some wholesome entertainment nearby. He sure took care of his employees. I got no idea what's going to happen to us now that he's gone.
I'm looking for a good souvenir.
Well, good souvenirs is all I got. What can I fix you up with?
Something small, furry, and yellow.
Something small, furry, and yellow.
Sorry, this is the only set of teeth I got.
You.
Dang, there goes another one.
You.
How about that little car there?
It's small, but it's not cheap, my friend. You better just take it for a test drive to make sure.
I would have done that.
Bunnies, and plenty of them.
You want bunnies? I got you bunnies. How much you got on you?
Can I just take them out for a test drive?
I think you may not be ready for the kind of commitment that comes with a Corley Bunny Value Pack. Sorry, son.
Oh, I love me some bunnies.
Those shirts come in extra, extra large?
Eh. No, but they're pre-shrunk.
No thanks. What do those pennants say on them?
Can't beat a Corley, they say. Kind of ironic, actually, considering how he died. Still, look great on your bedroom wall.
No walls. My bike is my home.
We could set you up with a little pole so you could make a flag, you know, for your back seat.
I'll think about it.
Do you actually have any money?
As much as I need.
Yeah, seen any vultures around here?
Seen any vultures around here?
Nah, we don't have much of a vulture problem here, even though their hideout is right up the road. They stay pretty much locked up in there. Not very social.
Hmm. Yeah, why? What is he drinking?
What's in the hat?
I don't know. Came filled with it.
Okay.
Probably some sort of packing material. Packs a punch, I'll tell you that much.
Some sort of packing material.
Looky here. Nothing personal, but why don't you mosey along and stop scaring away all the other customers, all right?
Just clearing my throat.
Other customers.
If we don't got it, then it stinks. Pat the bunny. You know you want to.
Sure, I'll
you
pat
just
the bunny.
Can't get this stuff anywhere else, folks. All right, let's see the cash, amigo.
I'll owe you.
No bucks, no yucks, compadre.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And it.
Excuse me, but are those shirts, are they all cotton?
Well, let's just see here.
Yoink!
100% cotton.
Oh, that's too bad. I'm allergic to cotton.
I'm practically giving this loot away. What's a couple of bucks in exchange for a timeless memento?
See you later.
Yeah.
Oh, he's on the bike, don't we? Because he's not going to go.
I don't walk.
Woo!
There's the vulture's hideout on the other side of this field. I've heard a lot about the vultures. And I guess it's all true.
I remember going into Tim's office at one point as the deadline was looming, saying, Tim, you gotta cut the mine road or the bunnies.
Oh, God. I remember.
He's like, I'm not cutting either one.
Mine road or the bunnies?
Yeah, I'm like, you gotta cut one, Tim. Something's gotta go.
We'd already cut so much on this game, I was like, we can't cut anymore. And the bunnies are crucial to the narrative.
Absolutely. What other game can you put bunnies in here to get blown the hell out of? I mean, look at this, so cute and cuddly! Dun, 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 dun. There we go. That's, you know, why he couldn't just take the battery out of the bunny, I'll never know. Maybe he didn't have a Swiss Army pen knife or something. Maybe his big fingers couldn't just, big banker fingers couldn't, you know, open the little clasp. back down here. Where's it gone? Okay.
These souvenirs all have an expected appreciation rate of 300% per year. Don't crowd everybody. There's enough for everyone. That's right. Official Corley Motors Smashatoriums.
That should put some life into it.
Sure, sure. Take it for a spin. Just don't go out of range.
Got a what now?
Don't go away empty-handed.
Do you remember going to Skywalker Ranch to record a video that was for marketing purposes, which was the Gone Jackals playing? And I don't know what, this is for some B-roll that we recorded for marketing use, but they also took a picture of the band and they made a leather jacket that said Full Throttle on it. And we filmed them playing in the same soundstage that the London Symphony Orchestra did Star Wars music on. And I just remember them came in and they wanted to pose with their bikes on the soundstage. And so they rolled, there was like the night watchman who was like letting us into the building. We had permission to be in there, but he's like saw the motorcycles getting wheeled in. He's like, are those okay to be indoors? I'm like, yeah. And like, and he asked one of the, we had these actual biker guys who own the bikes, wheel them in. And he's like, are they gonna leak on the woods, a hardwood floor in here? And the biker guy was just like, she'll leave her mark.
Well, that's a good segment.
But it's no big deal.
Okay, that's far enough, bud.
Sure. Aha.
Hey, don't go in there. Now look what you did. The entrance is all the way through the factory.
Oh, dear.
Hang on, little buddy. Daddy's coming.
Now it's just me and the bunnies.
There was...
Just a second. Yoink!
There...
Yeah, okay. Invasion of the Bunny Snatcher. That's a... Now, if you're good, you can get this done with one back box of bunnies. If not, then you have to try and do it with two. Well, you have to try again. I'm pretty sure you can use most of them and then... I think if you open the box and then...
The minefield's been replanted. Tidy little vultures.
So go as close as we can.
I hate surprises.
Yeah, we won't go any further. Right. So now you gotta pick up all 12 bunnies. Go, bunnies, go! Right. Now, from what I remember, this is completely random. Okay. You might get bad RNG as it is, or good RNG. Okay.
No. I don't want to set off any.
Closer.
I don't want to set off.
Jeez. There we go. We did it.
That's the guy I was telling you about, Susie.
You sure?
Yeah, that's the guy who killed my father.
All right, vultures, rack 'em up.
Let's rip them quick.
Listen, Mo, you're making a big mistake.
Oh, Ben, you're right. We shouldn't do this quickly. We should draw this out, don't you think, Susie?
Hey, I got all night. You heard her, kids. Let's draw this out.
Now, you could say all different things.
But I'm not going to...
Let me go, or else...
Or else what?
I'll call your names.
I'll call your names.
Like what?
Diaper Dynamo.
Diaper Dynamo.
How... did you hear that name?
Your father. He told me just before he died.
You bludgeoned my father and then talked about old times?
I didn't kill him. Ripberger did. A photographer took pictures, but her camera was stolen by the same thug that came after you.
I still have that role.
Well, develop it, would you, while I still fit in my clothes?
Okay, you stay here.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah, well, don't sweat it.
I'm gonna get Ripberger even if I die trying.
No, we have to expose Ripberger at the shareholders' meeting. That way, we take him down, we save my gang, and your father gets his dying wish. You take over Corley Motors.
Ripberger canceled the shareholders' meeting. He made a statement to the press that there'd be no meeting until the murderers were brought to justice.
So, no shareholders' meeting until we're both dead?
That could be arranged.
Okay, so here we go. Faking Ben and Maureen's death. Act 1, Scene 1. Adrian Ripberger, in a desperate attempt to lure our Maureen out of hiding, has developed the following lame-ass scheme. First prize at tonight's smash-up derby is a vintage hardtail that Mo restored with her dad. Rip hopes Mo will try to nab said bike on account of her sentimental attachment to it. So Ben and Mo play along, put on disguises, and enter the demolition derby, which ends tragically when their cars explode and both are presumed dead.
Question.
Please save your questions until the end. Now, the explosives in Mo's car can only be triggered by a head-on collision with Ben's car. This ejector seat projects Mo clear of the explosion, and she parachutes to safety.
Don't you think someone will notice her ejecting out of her car?
No, they'll all be watching you running around on fire.
Yeah, that's another question I have.
When your car explodes, you climb from it in flames and run around the stadium distracting the audience. In your cute little asbestos suit, of course.
That's some plan.
All right, then. Let's go blow your little darlings up.
All right, folks. Hang on to your chili dogs, because it's time to start. The Corley Motors Smashatorium Amateur Driver Ultimate Destruction Maximum Carnage Marathon.
Yeah.
Let's meet our crash cage gladiators.
Who's George?
Yep. George Lucas.
Oh, yeah.
That's just a lookalike.
That's awesome.
No, that's not George. It's
somebody in a George costume.
I love the hair.
See, Marina. They're all in disguise. Marine's got a wig on.
Now I'm just embarrassed for them.
Never realized that. All the things.
Ludicrous disguises.
And next to him is another masked newcomer. Please give a big smashatorium salute to the princess of pile-up, Doreen Schmorley.
All right, boys. Sick of him.
And finally, we have a last-minute addition to the lineup tonight. A deadly-looking team known as the Boom Boom Brothers.
Fine.
All right now, are you ready to see some reckless driving? Are you ready to see some unnecessarily violent destruction?
Let's see if I'm about to do this.
The demolition derby begin.
Where are you, Ben?
Hang on, Mo. Here I come.
Ooh. Okay, now they changed this. Okay. Hey, get out of the way! Oh, I got that back.
What are you doing? Get over here and nail me!
Look, they changed the controls. What do you want me to do?
when I bounced off the roof. Looks like these babies have a glass jaw.
Now I need to pull out this car, huh?
Forever.
Yeah, oh, I'm coming up.
Watch out for the Boom Boom Brothers, Mo.
Oh. That's it. They're back. Oh, there we go.
Okay, Boom Boom Brothers, it's all over.
Whee!
Get him! What are you doing? Are you taking a nap? Idiots.
Okay, Mo, time for our big finale.
Do it!
Now that's an explosion, ladies and gentlemen!
Yeah!
The suit, it is nothing!
Wait, what's that? It's the unknown Avenger! And he's on fire! Let's give him a hand, folks. That looks painful. We really should put him out right away, but what a show, huh? He's the runner and the torch all in one, folks. This is your moment to shine. Still no sign of Whoops. Out of hand. The stadium seems to be catching fire, but let's all remain calm and...
Yeah, run, you guys.
Yeah, you're right. The derby's over. Run for your life!
Finally. Now, squish that firefly while he's hot.
Uh-oh.
Look at him run.
Don't draw this at home, kids. Right. Jump!
Run!
Did you get him?
We finally got him, Bolas. That means Ripburger has to make us vice presidents now, like he promised, mm-hmm. and give us 10,000 shares of stock each.
Bye, guys.
Funny smell. What's that? The temperature light?
Oh, dear.
Well, on the bright side, I just made 20,000 shares of stock. Time to start the shareholders meeting.
Yes,
where's the hard deal?
All over the floor, Mr. Avenger.
What? What happened to your deep sentimental attachment to your father's vintage bike?
Ben, it's just a bike. I can put a bet together in about a half an hour. That's assuming, of course, I can find that key.
So, Keith of the Gone Jackals recommended a guy he knew who had a Harley with straight pipes, big old chopper, and every single cylinder stroke sounded literally like a cannon going off. I mean, literally. And that's Ben's bike. And we did a bunch of pass-bys and starts and all the things that you would do. But the best recording that came out was strapping a Walkman Pro with a cassette. It was a cassette recorder, which was actually really good that it wasn't digital, you know, that it was recording onto magnetic tape because it's such a loud sound pressure. And we strapped it on the back of his bike with a gooseneck going to an SM57, which for audio people who may not know, is often used on a snare drum. It can take a lot of sound pressure level, these mics. They just, you could mic, you know, a cannon.
It was invented for the military.
Oh, really, was it?
That's what Camden said the other day.
Wow, okay. He's probably right. So I just strapped it on the back of his bike, and he just rode around. And that ended up being, the cleanest recordings, the best recordings. We got accelerates, we got steadies, we got all kinds of stuff from that. And much of it was cut in without any processing or pitch shift or anything like that. It was just the sound of that wonderful Harley. So the driver of that almost dumped it, though, because it started raining. So we had to store it in the LucasArts lobby.
Right.
And.
What key are you talking about?
Key to my dad's safe. I remember he hid it somewhere on this bike, but I've looked everywhere and I can't find anything that even looks like a key.
What's in the safe that's so important?
My dad's will. I'm counting on him to tell the truth about me, finally.
Why did he keep you a secret all these years?
He didn't want people to find out about my mom.
What's so bad about Mrs. Corley?
She wasn't my mom.
Duh. Come on, that's kind of obvious.
But how are we going to get in the factory?
In the back of the factory, there's a secret entrance that leads straight into Dad's office. He used to sneak me in so I could help him with his bike designs.
When he got too old to do all the work himself?
Nah, this is back when I was six.
How do I find the secret passage?
Well, it's tricky. You have to wait for all the utility meters to turn black. Then you kick the wall in just the right spot, and you're in.
How do I find the right spot to kick?
Dad just knew exactly where to kick it. But I remember that there was this big crack in the wall, and if I lined up that crack with my eye level and kicked the wall right in front of me, this weird portal would open up.
How was your flight?
Well, there were some explosions during takeoff, and I landed in a minefield. But other than that, it was fine.
I'm fine, by the way. Thanks for asking.
Great. Now help me find that key.
What are we in, anyway?
It's a C-330 Big Mouth Industrial Cargo Jumbo Transport we fixed up. We want to get it rolling so we can take it to biker rallies.
You're going to try to fly this thing?
Rolling, Ben. Rolling. This baby's flying days are over, just like mine.
Remember that time you tried to kill me?
Yeah, we really taught you a lesson. Get it?
I'll see what I can do.
Right.
Okay. So, what we need... is you can lift all these bits and pieces. And despite him sounding like an electrical tower, we want 1544.92. 1544.92. Yeah.
Here, take the photos. I don't want them. Show them to someone important if you get a chance. Whee!
Still on fire. Now, how's our bunny situation? Got two bunnies. All right, that'll do. Go around the back.
Okay, I have to talk about this puzzle because it's causing me a lot of grief. This is the second puzzle everyone gets stuck on, and they hate
oh,
and
yeah,
they get really angry.
One.
So the puzzle is supposed to be that you have to line up your knees, your eyes with the crack on the wall, and the puzzle is supposed to be that you, Maureen wasn't a grown-up woman at that time. She was only a four-year-old girl, so the crack should be much lower, and if you go there and kick it, it works. But we're worried people would just brute force it and kick everything, so we made it so you couldn't kick it unless all these gauges were all lined up, which is a little contrived. And so, but the thing, that's where I learned the rule of adventure games. If it's possible at all to brute force something, they will do it. They'll be like, well, I guess I just got to kick every pixel on this wall. And so people would kick every pixel and be like, why did you make that stupid puzzle where you have to kick every pixel? And I'm like, it was supposed to be this other thing.
It was to figure it out.
It's supposed to think the way I thought about it. And so that was a big learning experience for me.
Now, a look here.
Well, this must be Mo's wall. Don't see anything special about it, except for that crack she mentioned.
So, you can see a little bit of green on it. But in reality, you should look like that, and it's right there. But you gotta time it. So, wait for it. Go. Alakazam. First try. Woo!
I do remember one time, like right as we were about to ship, I was testing it at home, like all night long, trying to crash it. And I like started to doze off, and my cat walked across the keyboard.
I remember that.
And crashed the game.
Oh, that's right, the cat crash bug.
Cat bug.
And we could never, your cat would not reproduce it for us.
Not reproduce that bug.
And they were like, but we've got to fix it. And it's like,
bring the cat in. Bring
get
the cat in.
Pro. I can't.
Did you thank that
everybody
cat in the credits?
Get a
what was
cat.
The name of that cat?
We started
cat?
Bringing cats into the pit.
Did you thank it in the credits? What cat was that?
It was Eartha, and she was thanked.
Thank you.
Look at that stadium burn. That's going to take a bite out of the pension fund. Very austere. No drawers. Furniture moving? No.
Alright. Floor safe.
There's some sort of card. A tape. I sure hope that's Corley's will.
I do remember one.
Yeah, okay.
This is the last game I ever programmed on, I believe. I remember doing Ben crawling all over the semi and doing the bunny stuff, which is maybe why I was such a problem. This is an interesting transition for me in learning about schedules and how terrible and hard they are. Because Dance Tentacle, I feel like, was the last game we did that was on time.
Yeah.
It was not a breeze, but it was like no crunch mode, followed the schedule. And part of that is because we had an extra 6 months at the end because of adding the voice. Yeah.
Right.
But and this is the first game that went way over budget that I worked on, and the first time I had a producer, which is Casey. So she would come in, and I just remember you asked you
like a specter.
Yeah, she'd come in and be like, Tim. When is this going to be done? And I just remember that weird feeling. I told this to you, like, I don't know how to express this, but I feel like you come in and ask me that question, and then I look over to the place where that information is, and I see this empty box with cobwebs in it. And then I come back, I'm like, I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah, it's worth mentioning that if you come here before, if you do somehow manage to get in here with that before you, the stadium bit, you get chased out by a security guard.
Cool. Looks like the meeting started.
Was not only an inspirational leader, but also a great personal friend. His loss affects us all deeply. Malcolm and I spoke often of the future. We talked of a day when Corley Motors would move beyond its humble beginnings into a new vehicular age. And although his tragic death took him from us sooner than anyone expected, Malcolm Corley's dream remains. And I shall carry out that dream in his memory. Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to present to you the future of Corley Motors. The Corley Minivan. Corley was right. I never dreamed it would actually come to minivans, though.
So this is the... At the time, this is the worst thing we could think of to happen, which was that the motorcycle company would start making minivans. They're pretty new in the 90s, right?
That's true.
That's when they emerged. They were the epitome of just selling out and living a suburban life.
Yeah, I've got one.
I would love to have one right now.
Yep.
But that was like the worst vehicle we could think of.
They
were really ugly initially, too.
And nowadays, it would be like, I don't know, SUV? No, I don't know. It would be something that would imply that a motorcycle company had sold out completely. Because we were like, how do you make it, you know, motorcycles, they live with a high-risk situation. How do you really threaten, how do you make something really scary? Like, their life is, their way of life is going to end, and it's that their favorite motorcycle brand would start making this symbol of a normal life.
Of domesticity.
Domesticity,
exactly. Suburban bliss. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. Let's shut this thing in here up, shall we? Right, so we push this one up. And. No, up. And then down.
Ah. What the hell is going on up there?
I'm on it. Just a lamp adjustment. Be fixed in no time.
Yes.
Didn't do it fast enough.
As I was saying, I hate this old equipment. My girdle needs less adjusting.
Right, let's try this again. Down. Up. Well, down. And up again.
What you see before you right now is my vision for Christmas.
Whoops! Oh dear.
Oh, perfect. This is a disaster.
You're telling me? We're gonna have some major downtime here. Why don't you tell a joke or something?
I don't know any jokes. You know, this reminds me of an amusing anecdote about a. Well, I'm out of ideas.
I don't know what that's supposed to be.
When is it that George came down and spoke to us all, and he said he had his 55% rule? There was a game that precipitated that.
I thought it was 40. If you get 45% of what you want, then you're...
No, 55.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was 55. No, it was just over half. He goes, if you've got this great idea and you think it's going to be killer, and you know, through the realities of relegating it with a team and all the collaboration, all the technical limitations, you get it to 55% of relegating your concept, the audience will get it. And it's time to let go and ship your products, folks. Like, come on.
Right.
This is a business, after all.
Hmm. I'm not really sure that should be something that you would never do. Let's do this.
Now, this next slide shows our new, more aggressive corporate strategy.
Okay, first.
Where'd you get the idea of him? It's having a New England accent? It's really cool.
I don't
hear with these bikers.
In this, the voice for this game, I was more removed from it than I would be on future games. I got really involved in the casting.
Okay.
So I was involved in the casting of Ben and stuff, but Tamlin, Neilio, and Chris Brown did a lot of it on their own, and they went and recorded definitely without me. And so, I don't remember. And Tamlin's thing was we got to differentiate all these characters.
Right.
And that's where a lot of the crazy accents come from, is like we got to make them stand out from each other.
We work. Great.
All right, that's enough. How do I turn this damn thing off?
Of course, legally, you'd have to be in for the witnesses. Yeah.
I hear that tape from one of Malcolm's psychiatric sessions.
Of your emotion.
Near the end, he suffered many paranoid delusions. He was haunted by powerful forces of his own creation.
And here's one of them. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Maureen Corley, and do I have a heck of a story for you. By the time I'm done, you'll see why this man should be in jail. Hey! Where do you hobble off to?
Uh-oh. There he goes.
And then
I love
he sent
Ben
his
runs.
Goons after me.
Run, Rip Burger. When it's time to find you, we'll just follow the shiny trail.
Yes, of course we'll have daycare facilities. Any other questions? Oh, speak of the devil. Come over here, Ben. That was great, Ben. You're finally where we were meant to be all along.
Yeah. Oh, look, my gang's still in jail. Remember that?
So, after we pick up your bike, we'll go get my gang out of jail.
And then find out why my gang never showed up to help us.
And then you go business suit shopping.
Well, that's the end of the game, guys. Thank you for watching. No, really.
Don't complain. You're going to be rich.
Money, money, money. Settle for just a little peace and quiet.
Oh, yeah. Like, driving stick.
She interrupted my speech then. She really shouldn't have. I was just about to talk about the inherent dangers of motorcycle operation.
Behind you, dude.
Can't you make this damn thing go any faster?
Okay, now. So this.
That fans like a big one.
Okay. Sorry. Wee! I'll have that. There we go.
My cane!
You'll need more than a cane when I'm through with you, Rip Burger.
Great. Pain plus fan. Don't stop. And overheating engine. Whee! Okay. Now I know which wire it is because you can see a nut in that one, but you can't really see it in the remastered. Oh.
Woo!
Oops. Not good.
I thought you said this thing couldn't move.
I said it couldn't fly. I never said it couldn't taxi.
Well, flying would be nice since we're headed for the gorge.
Ripburger, you're going to kill all of us.
Shh, Ben, don't ruin the ending.
How do you stop this thing?
From the cockpit.
Okay.
Doc!
Careful, Ben.
Don't worry, ladies, these bullets won't get me. By the way, did I throw fertilizer in that person's place?
I could have used those.
Right. Landing. No, hang on. In flight. No. Takeoff, that's it. Post takeoff, gear, race.
Here goes nothing.
What the?
What did you do?
Yeah. My gun. Your gun. My gun. To me, to you, to me. Ah! Oh boy.
Ben! Ben! Are you alive?
I am, but I don't know about Rip Burger.
I can see him. He's out cold.
Yeah, right.
Climb back here, quick.
Okay.
I feel like I remember programming this part too, because it was all this.
Oop. Okay.
Oop. I feel like I remember programming this part too, because it was all this is all like a reference to Dr. Strangelove. The code that you enter is I think preserve our essence.
Yeah. Which is big, Peter.
Peace on earth. Purity of essence.
Yeah.
Purity of essence, right? Or peace on earth. Something like that.
Mandrake, ever been a prisoner of war?
Yeah.
Why, yes, sir.
Yes, Jack. As a matter of fact, I have.
Right. Warning, fuel leave. This vehicle has been reported as stolen. Machine guns, control. Fire!
I think you just killed a seagull!
Whoops. Kill the animals! Oh no. Oh no. Ah! Oops.
Let me try that again.
Oh, okay. Another. Oh. It's me listening to the commentary. Damn you, Tim Schafer! Oh. Anyway, I had to kill the seagull. Sorry.
Ben! Climb back here, quick!
Right. Yeah. Defense, machine guns, control, off. Bye! Can't beat a coolie! No! See ya! Bye!
Well, answers that.
Wait, come back! We need your weight in the plane!
So this is a big question for the remaster because the aspect ratio is wider.
Yes.
One of the puzzles here is as you run out of this, you don't see Ben's bike lurking in the corner. So you try to run for it and then you blow up. But
it was a
puzzle to like you have to walk to the left to pan over to see the Ben's bike. But now I think it's just going to show.
Oh. Let's go. Kick him.
And I think the explosion looks like a giant croissant chasing you out of the plane. Watch this. Look for the croissant.
Must have been breakfast.
Here comes. And croissant.
Yeah.
Delicious. That's my favorite. Okay, that is a favorite.
That's the best shot.
It does. It so does.
Life was a game to him. And he played it. By his own rules. He was a mystery to most of us. And yet, an inspiration to us all. He gave us freedom. He gave us power. He gave us wings. He gave us wheels. Thank you, Malcolm Corley, for giving us a dream that will never die.
So? Maybe we could do lunch sometime next week.
Yeah, sure. Lunch sounds great.
Things aren't gonna change, are they, Ben? I mean, just because I'm in charge of the company now, and living in a mansion and riding around in limos, that doesn't mean we won't spend a lot of time together, does it?
Look, Mo, you're in a different league now. You shouldn't be hanging out with the likes of me anymore.
But Ben, just a second. Hello? What? No, that's crazy. Is he nuts? Look, move the meeting up to 5 and tell the plant foreman that I'm coming over personally to inspect those parts. I know, that's what I told him. Excuse me, what was that last part?
Unrequited,
no,
unrequited
that alloy
love.
Was flawed to unquieted? Begin with. Uh-huh, yeah. Yeah, good. Great.
The end. In memory of Roy Conrad.
Haitian political analysis?
That was our custodian. Like, we'd be working late in crunch mode, and the janitor would come by to clean up, and we'd end up talking to him for a long time. His name was Paul. Do you remember Paul? He had this crazy vacuum cleaner that he wore like a backpack, and he would go down all, and we would have these long talks with him about Haiti and stuff, because I was like, I think we'd seen Serpent in the Rainbow or something. We were like, tell us about the Tonton Macou. And he would tell us all about the real Haitian politics and stuff, and everyone got in the credits back then.
Lovely.
I don't know. Oh my God, I can't believe I got away with anything. Like, someone complained about not being in credits, so I put him in his wine. Oh, what a jerk. Now I totally remember why people hated me.
Following cat.
They're all our kitty cats.
Who are all these cats? This is what bothered me.
I've got three cats in there.
How come I didn't get my red cats?
Yeah, I stand by the statement. Hey,
isn't Jesus?
Mine are an Indian dog. Who is Monkey?
Yeah. Monkey. I forget now.
Tim would like to thank No Cats and does not endorse cat ownership. My male fantasy. Now profit making game. Maybe I'll get
any
the chicks.
Final thoughts you'd like to share? How'd you like working on that game?
A lot better than I remembered.
Wait, the game was better than you remembered?
Or working on it was better than you remembered?
No, it looks good. It looks pretty good. I'd play that.
It was really fun. It was a fun project.
I remembered late on that there was one Easter egg that apparently Clint and Mark Crowley put in.
Oh.
That one night I heard when they were getting punchy.
What Easter
what
egg
was
that?
I don't remember.
The safe.
The
when
safe.
When you punch in your code in the safe, if you enter Mark Crowley's birthday, then...
Oh.
Can it be said?
Do you remember that?
I don't even remember that. Yeah. This goes to show
is
you.
Is that ship in the game?
It's like Cooper
yes,
Carr.
Yes, man.
Because it was the whole thing where we were like saying that we had to know about like every single Easter egg, let us know so we knew it was there. And I guess they got punchy and decided to put it in.
There must have been some sort of vocal gratification.
So it's still
but all, these year, all these years yeah. later, we are we're grateful. We're grateful that made it in.
You know Mark Crowley and his birthday, you can find it.
It took us only 2 hours of playthrough to get to the farts. That's not bad.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Might have to try that. Alright. So that's pretty much it. Let's have a quick look at the bonus stuff. So you got the concept art, the jukebox. Everything's now unlocked, see? Cool. We got loads of concept art. So yeah, alright, well that was Full Throttle, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoyed it. I had lots of fun. And once again, I suppose I can say thank you guys for watching. If you enjoyed this playthrough, please check out my other ones on my lovely channel. It's around here somewhere. There's a subscribe button down there somewhere. Just, you know, the usual stuff. Like this video, subscribe, share, talk about it. And Quillhog smiled. There he is. Happy guy. Okay. Thanks for watching, guys.